Great. Well, we're happy that you're here, and we're happy that we're here, and that it's a little bit warmer than it was yesterday. So it makes it a lot more pleasant to have the sun shining. So, as you know, we are master gardeners, and we are members of the Herb Society of America. Now, the Herb Society of America is an old organization, and it started in 1933 in Boston. And one of the greatest accomplishments of the Herb Society of America is that they were the ones that instigated the National Herb Garden at the U.S. Arboretum in Washington, D.C. So still today, the Herb Society does support that garden, and we sponsor an intern to work there. So that is a great thing about our organization. We have 2,000 members across the United States, and we have and our group here is called the Texas Time Unit, and we meet in Huntsville. We meet once a month, and y'all are welcome to join us if you would like. We usually meet on the last Thursday of the month. Wednesday of the month. It's kind of been all screwed up since COVID. We've been doing different things. We've tried doing virtual meetings, and we've had a plant swap meeting so we could just meet outside. So we're doing different things. But anyway, we have about 35 members. And if you're familiar with Huntsville at all, there's a big historic home in Huntsville called the Wynn Home. Well, we have the gardens in the backyard of the Wynn Home. And you all are welcome, if you're ever in Huntsville, to go back there and explore those gardens. This is a picture of our garden right here. It's a very photogenic, beautiful garden. There's an herb garden there, and behind the statue is a children's sensory garden, and we have a rose garden there. So our group, which is about 35 members, we maintain that garden, and we expand it, and do whatever. We have an herb festival every spring in March. We scheduled for March 28th. I think we're going to have it.
I hope so.
We hope so. It's all outside.
We're keeping our fingers crossed.
Yeah, that is great because there will be all kinds of herbs there. Not only herbs, but perennials. We're also big into pollinator plants, so we have a lot of pollinator plants, and it's most of the stuff that we grow ourselves. So you know, a lot of them are passed along plants. So yeah, it's a great place to buy plants. And usually we have vendors, and we have speakers, and we have music, and we have food, and all kinds of things. So it's a great place to come and just spend a couple of hours and buy plants. It's great. Okay, all right. So we're here to learn about herbs. And I have to, when you talk about herbs, you also have to talk about spices as well. Because spices come from herbs, if I'd like to think. And the spices are the roots, the seeds, and the bark. If any of those parts are used of a plant, that's called a spice. Herbs generally refer to just the leaves, usually, just and the flowers. And an example of an herb that is also a spice is dill. You know, it gets dill seed, and dill seed is a spice. And then there's also coriander, or cilantro. The seed of cilantro is coriander, and that's a spice, but the cilantro is considered an herb. So most of the herbs are grown in, you know, in temperate climates, but spices are usually come from tropical climates. You think of cardamom, or cloves, or allspice, or cinnamon. All of those things usually come from more tropical areas like Mexico and, you know, farther south. So why do we study herbs anyway? They're a part of our history. You know, they have found evidence of herbs in fossils, very old fossils, and on writings, ancient writings, stone tablets. So they have been used for, you know, since 4000 BC, they have found evidence of herbs being used. And mostly they were used for medicine, for the most part. And it really isn't until the late 1800s that all medicine was plant-based. So it's only recently that we've started using artificial chemicals for medicine. They are really, really versatile plants. That's another reason why we like to, we are so excited about them, because they're so versatile. You can just see up here as an example, they're beautiful, they're useful as food, and to spice up your food. They're great in the landscape. They make excellent landscape plants, as you can see by these salvias. Medicine, they are a lot of them you can use the wood to make, just to make any kind of a wood product. Because there are herbal trees as well. And a lot of them are used for dyes and a lot of craft purposes. Some of the herbs are used as to make rope. So they're incredibly useful plants. They're also great as pollinator plants. Like, for instance, these salvias, the bees and the hummingbirds just love these things. So a lot of them are just wonderful as pollinator plants. And I'm sure you all have learned how important pollinators are to our 80% of all the plants and all the flowering plants need pollinators in order to produce seeds and fruits and vegetables. So, and also with herbs as seasoning, every cuisine in the world use spices in some way. So that are herbs in some way. So all of that all just ties us all together as a world community. The herbs and spices do that. Now, I mentioned that they are important as medicine and were very important as medicine a long time ago. But with the Herb Society tells us that as representing the Herb Society, we can only advise you and we can only tell you about the herbs. We cannot recommend dosages or diagnose a remedy for you and by using herbs. We cannot do that as members of the Herb Society. We can just inform you about them. Herbs can be very powerful. If you take a lot of them, they can have interactions with other drugs you're taking. So if you do use a lot of herbs, you need to talk to your healthcare provider about the herbs that you're using. Herbs are very easy to grow. I'm sure you all have herbs already growing in your yards. Yes? Okay. Well, you know they're easy. A lot of them originate in the Mediterranean area, so they like a lot of sun. They like well-drained soil. You don't really have to fertilize them. They grow pretty well all by themselves. So they're easy to grow, except, if you keep them in the sun and you keep them well-drained. There are some that like shade, so there are herbs that you can put in the shade. Many of them are perennial. Another nice thing about the herbs are that they're easy to propagate. A lot of times you can just take a cutting of them and just stick them in dirt, and voila, you have a plant. So that's a nice thing about herbs. So I'm going to talk about. I wanted to say, they're also good in containers, because, especially now, this time of year, if you put them in a container, you can put them by your back door and you always have them during the winter. You don't have to trudge out into your yard to get the herbs. And they make pretty containers, the nice thing about a container, and Jean has a good example of containers in her yard, because, they lift up, you put them among your plants and it lifts up your landscape. It just lifts up your eyes.
Keeps the rabbits from getting them.
Yeah, that's another thing. But it makes it easier for the deer to get them. So, and also, they're good in containers because they do like well-drained soil. So, containers do have good drainage. So I'm going to talk about, we're going to talk about some of our favorite herbs or more interesting herbs. And I chose to talk about the herbs in the Laminaceae family, and otherwise known as the mint family. So all the herbs that I talk about, the salvias and the thymes and the rosemaries and the lavender, they're all in the mint family. And one interesting thing about the mint family is that they all have square stems. So you can go and you can find out for yourself, go ahead and touch them and verify them. Yes, they all do have square stem. So if you find a plant with a square stem, you can be almost pretty certain that it will be in the Laminaceae family. Okay, I'm going to talk about sage first. Sage and salvia are the, and we have handouts for you guys, so don't worry about taking too many notes. We do have some pretty good handouts. This is July 12th. Okay. So sages refer to plants that are more colorful. Sage. Are referred to as sages, and the ornamental sages are called salvias, which are these. This is here. This one is an exception. This is a pineapple sage.
Say, I don't have that. My sage doesn't bloom that.
Yeah, this is a separate one. This is pineapple sage, but I stuck it in here because it looks more like a salvia flower, but you could use it as a culinary sage.
It smells something really strong.
Yeah.
Is that one?
Well, it's either that or the rosemary.
Yeah, but this is more of, the pineapple sage is more of a dessert type of, just you can smell it. The big rough leaves, that's your culinary sage, one of them. And then this is one that I use as a dessert.
Okay.
Yeah,
see if you smell that one.
Yeah, smell it.
Yeah, rosemary.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's
mild one.
Yeah, it is. Well, we have a recipe book here. It isn't ours, but it's friend
this
of ours.
One is like regular
for
sage.
Your dressing, yes.
That's regular sage, and this is pineapple, correct?
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Smell the different ones. Mm. Yeah, totally different.
Yeah, I rub it, dry it, and rub it. Rub sage for. Dressing, you know.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I don't buy sage.
Yeah. Well, you know, once you start growing herbs, just the other day, I was making a recipe and I went to my spice rack and opened up a McCormick jar of I can't remember what spice or what herb it was, and this doesn't smell at all. So once you start growing these and using them, you really think that the McCormick stuff and the stuff you buy in the grocery store is not good. So you start to try your own, and you know you do it every season or every once in a while. You always have something that's fresh. So that's another great thing about growing these beautiful versatile plants. So the sages we use, as you know, in stuffings, soups, stews. So that's what we use the sages for, and they are easy to, well, they don't really like humidity, so they do struggle with the humidity, so sometimes they won't last a long time. They'll just
drainage, yeah.
Yes. We have, in our herb garden at the Wynn home, we have this beautiful Jerusalem sage. It was gorgeous, and it had the beautiful flower on it, too. And it was huge, and this year it just died.
If we get heavy rains, like 10 inches, or you know, when these hurricanes, they bite the best. That and lavender too.
So that is one thing about the culinary sages. They are a good source of vitamin A and C. And as we say, that they used to dry the leaves and use them as medicine. And even today, we can use the sage as medicine. If you dry the leaves and make a tea out of it, you can use it as a gargle for sore throat. It will work. It's also, a long time ago, it was thought that it would relieve hot flashes. And also, they used it as a fertility treatment until the 18th century. It was also used way long time ago to treat liver disease and epilepsy. And that was in the Middle Ages when they used it for those purposes. And today we use it in cosmetics. It's used to make soap and shampoo and perfume, and also as a dye. It was also used as a tea in colonial times. You know, when the British, we had a problem with tea from Britain. Well, the colonists found all kinds of ways to make tea, and that sage was one of the things that they used. And by the way, our common yopon was another very popular source of tea for the colonists. And long ago, the sage was associated with long life, wisdom, and improved memory. So that, so, you know, they would use that, that's what Polly thought, sage interacted with the body, and so they would use that to treat those diseases that were, you know, if you had memory problems, they would probably prescribe herbalism, prescribe some sage tea. So, and then, it, then there are the salvias, which are these beautiful plants. And they are more of the ornamental sages. And they come from the Latin word salvo, which means safe, whole, and healthy. But these salvias like sun, they will tolerate a little bit of shade. And if they have adequate moisture, they'll just keep blooming for you, and they'll bloom throughout the winter time too. They do benefit with cutting them back in midsummer, and they'll produce new flowers. But they're great, and they're easy to propagate. And of course, these tubular flowers, you can see the hummingbirds, they just love it because they can stick their little noses and their proboscis in there and extract all of the content that they need. And Salvia hispanica, I don't have an example of that, is what they make the chia pets out of. And there are some salvias that are native, and there's one in here, oh, here's a Salvia greggii. It has a little tiny flower. This is a native salvia. And there are several other salvias that are native. And it is thought that the salvias repel insects. So that's it for salvias. Before y'all go home, you can take some of these if you want, and you can try starting these from, you know, cut off just a little piece of it. Like I'm gonna see this. If you would just take this and stick it in the dirt, you'll have a new plant.
Wow.
So most of these in my yard came from plants. Welcome to try your hand at doing it. You won't need to come to our plant sale then.
Will they last through the winter? I have a whole bunch of pineapple sage.
Yeah.
Not in her area, I bet.
Yeah. You don't think it would grow?
It would. Not. She said, will it last through the winter?
Oh, it does in my yard.
Yeah, she lives further south.
Yeah, I live.
Even mine, sometimes I get lucky, different locations, but I take cuttings just to be sure.
Okay, so I can talk to you later about what to do with all the big herbs I have.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Good. Yeah, a lot of times if you plant them closer to your house and maybe it's out of the wind, you might have luck over winter.
You're southeast next
to the house. Yeah, that would be sunny. Okay, rosemary. Rosemary is really an interesting plant. And this is the prostrate variety. Oh, okay, sage. You need to stand up. That's the surrounding. This is the one that's really small.
That's the one.
So from the propagation class, y'all did some prostate rosemary.
Did you?
How's it doing? Is it growing? Is it
my
living?
Tall one's alive. My one that's the other way is dead.
I think it's that. I thought the Luther rosemary would die. If I'm within 5 feet, I don't know why.
No, it
probably you'd love it too much.
It smells good.
This prostrate blooms better for me. It's a really good bloomer. But yeah, it can't stand a lot of loving. You have to ignore it.
Maybe that's
enough
humid water.
Oh, yeah.
Right. Yeah.
That's another
too much
one of
water.
Those
yeah,
herbs
like to be
it
dry.
Yeah, that's one of the herbs that's native to the Mediterranean area. And if you know anything about that area, it's dry and sunny.
I'm gonna show them the greggy. Okay. This is the salvia greggy she was talking about. It's right now, it's in my garden.
So that's okay.
Yeah, they come in different colors, different whites, pinks.
And they're beautiful.
What is this?
Savio greggii.
That's a native.
And if you're familiar with lyre leaf sage, that's another native sage. It's kind of, it's more of a like more of a ground cover. It's very low to the ground and gets a just kind of a stalk more like this. It's a stalk more like that. And that's a native sage. But rosemary is interesting because it used to be called Rosmarinus officinale. That's what its botanical name used to be until about 2 years ago. And botanists they've discovered DNA, how DNA can help them classify plants. So they've started taking DNA of plants, and they decided, well, rosemary is not its own, it's really a salvia. So now it's the botanical name for rosemary is Salvia rosmarinus. So this is happening.
See, all we're doing that.
You have to check now. Whenever you look for the botanical name of something, you have to check because they're always that bone set we were talking about is another one where they have the bone set and the white snake root. They have changed one of them. I think the snake root. The snake root they moved into another classification.
Good.
So you always have to. You just never know. Things are always changing. So anyway, but I wanted to get back to, it was called Rosmarinus officinale, and whenever you see the term officinale after a botanical name, you know that plant was once used as a medicine. Back when Linnaeus did the the classification of plants in the middle of 1740s, 50s, he named a lot of the plants in the plant world, and He anything that was used as a medicinal plant, he called it officinale. That's what he added to the name. So whenever you see that, you know that plant is used as a medicine at some point. Okay, and the rosemary, of course, it's evergreen here. And just don't take care of it too much because it doesn't like a whole lot of care. And the prostate rosemary is great. I mean, it's a great ground cover. It looks beautiful hanging over a wall, and it gets these beautiful blue flowers usually in the winter time. So, when nothing else is blooming, that one is blooming. Well, let's see. And of course, the tall, upright rosemary makes a great landscape plant because it gives you that tallness in the back of your. If you have beds, you know, have something tall, something short, it gives you that tall look. Let's see, and it does have a strong flavor. These stems, if you remove all of these, you know, all of this, you can use these as a skewer and use them as, you know, for barbecue. You can get a bunch of these together and make like a brush, dip it in barbecue sauce and use it as a basting brush, and that way you're imparting some flavor into your meat as well. I marinate steaks with sprigs of rosemary. Some people throw the rosemary on coals whenever they're barbecuing meat, and that gives you some flavor too on the meat. And you can cut the sprigs and put them under the skin of a chicken when you're baking a chicken. Put some under the skin or put them in the cavity, and that'll give it a nice flavor. But it is strong, so you have to not use a whole lot of it. I like rosemary because there are just a ton of stories about it. There's an old legend that it used to have white flowers until the Virgin Mary, you know, when they were fleeing Egypt, she threw her cloak over a white bush that was supposed to be rosemary, and the flowers turned blue. That's one of my favorite stories. And it's an herb that's associated with remembrance. So the ancients thought that it helped with your memory. And in fact, the Greeks used, they would make wreaths out of it and put it around their head when they were taking their examinations because they thought that it helped them to remember things better and they would do well. So every year we have the third graders from all the Huntsville schools come to our garden for a tour, and we tell them about that. We tell them that story, and we give them all a piece of rosemary. We say, now you stick this behind your ear, because when you go back to your classroom, the teacher is going to say, what did you learn? And this will help you remember what all you learned. So it's cute because even the little boys do that. They put that
spring. We need that when we take our final.
Exactly.
So it was used as an herb of remembrance, and they used to put it in funeral bouquets. It was also known as an herb of happiness. So brides would put it in their bouquet as well. There's this whole thing about the language of flowers, and the different herbs mean, and flowers mean different things, and the rosemary meant happiness. And studies show, and this is something that's a true, but studies show that it helps with hair growth. In fact, I go to this lady who cuts my hair, and she uses a rosemary shampoo on my hair all the time. And she swears, she says, "I think you're getting more hair." she firmly believes that it really helps. So, and I think it probably does do something. And anyway, but it's also used in aromatherapy because it helps to increase alertness and enhances your memory. You know, that's been what the ancient Greeks believed anyway. Okay, so that's rosemary. And now we move on to thyme. And I've got some examples here of thyme. Let's see, one is a mother of thyme and one is an English thyme. And again, this thyme is in the mint family as well. And it does like a sunny, well-draining location. It really needs well-drained soil. It is a perennial, but it doesn't kind of like this time of year, I don't think, because mine kind of doesn't look that great. It does get woody, so you do have to trim it to help it grow better. So it makes a great ground cover, and you can use it in a rock garden. It looks really pretty in a rock garden. In fact, Jean has a picture of one. I don't know if you still have that. All the thymes that are different colors of thymes, and they were spread among her rocks. It was really pretty, very pretty.
Let me tell you now. I have it the best thyme that I have. I put concrete blocks around my vegetable garden. And put soil down in I set it up so the holes were open. It's made the best thyme in the world, and it's gone over the rocks and into my garden area. So that's it's confined there and it has to drain. It drains well, so that's a good place to do it too.
Yeah. That's the key, is the well draining. Mm-hmm. I have mine cascading over a wall, and I planted it right next to the rocks. Mm-hmm. So that it really stays pretty dry.
I'm lucky. I just planted a vegetable garden like that, put some blocks and put some thyme in there. It's like, I didn't like that. You said that. Boy, that was lucky.
It does well. And mine's actually doing very well this time of year, I guess.
Yeah.
Well, it's been dry. We haven't had the fall rains like we usually get. Some of these hurricanes come in, and we have not had that. So I think that's why the thyme's doing so well.
Okay, so long ago, thyme was a symbol of bravery and courage, and it was thought that the scent of thyme would give soldiers courage, and this was back in the Middle Ages, and they would have thyme sewn into their clothes, and they would bathe in thyme before they would go into battle, because they thought that just made them brave. Thyme does contain thymol, and it can be used for its antioxidant, antifungal, anti-inflammatory, and antibacterial properties. And even today, we use it as a gargle for sore throat and bad breath. You've heard of the Listerine, right? Mm-hmm. Well, that the active ingredient in that is thymol, which comes from thyme.
Wow.
And we still use it for that, for those same things. Antiseptic for your mouth, and if you have a sore throat, it's a good sore throat gargle. And Jean makes this thyme honey, if you want to tell them about your thyme honey.
Okay, and it really works. It's really easy, it really works. I used lemon thyme in this honey, but you have to dry it. Like, I dehydrated it at a very low heat so that it wouldn't, because the first that I made, I just went out and got some thyme, put it in my little jar, put honey over it, and it did well. but in about a month it molded. So in order to keep the moisture, that was because they had moisture in it. So in order to not do that, I dehydrated and then just fill my little jar up with thyme and pour honey over it, put it in a sunny window for like 2 weeks. That's the best. I, sometimes you just get this cough, you take one little spoon of that and it's gone. And my granddaughter was coughing, keeping her mother up, and she said, "I don't know what I've done, can't get any rest." I said, "I gave you some thyme honey." So she gave it to her, she said she slept all night. So it's really, really wonderful. I strain mine. You don't have to strain it, but all those little leaves in there, I don't like that, so I strain it. That was last winter, so it keeps indefinitely.
And how much time did you put in there?
I just fill the jar full.
Okay.
Yeah. Easy, easy. And perfect time of the year to start doing it.
Yeah, this is the time to start gathering your herbs and drying them and saving them for the rest of the winter. Use them. So, as you see, we still use thyme today as a home remedy. And we use it as in cooking all the time. And I always like to say that if you don't know what herb to use, you can use thyme, because it's not a strong herb, but it does impart some flavor. It's great with chicken and pork and delicate fish dishes. So. Yeah, so that it works that way. Let's see. Let's pass these around. You can kind of smell these and see if you can tell any difference in the different thymes. There are all kinds of thymes. There's lemon thyme, orange thyme.
Lemon thyme is my favorite.
Yeah, caraway thyme. There are all kinds.
Not much difference in those two.
This one's a lot stronger.
Yeah,
to me.
Do we have any lemon thyme here, Lord?
Yes, we do.
Just a pig's quart of it.
Okay.
She's going to get a piece of lemon thyme too, so you can smell it.
Okay. Lavender is another one of those plants that's in the mint family, and I didn't bring any lavender, but I did bring some lavender shortbread cookies for y'all. And you can take a bag of them home with you, or eat them here, whatever. As I said, that's another one of those, it is in the mint family, but kind of difficult to grow here because of the humidity. They really don't like, they don't like a lot of rain. Again, it's a Mediterranean herb, so if you can, a lot of people put like gravel or pea gravel underneath the plant so that it'll grow better. Yeah. I think it does do better in a pot because of the drainage issue. It makes a pretty flower.
It's really big out here, nice and full.
Oh wow.
Yeah, isn't it great? That's what I use for my honey. It gives you that lemon.
Okay, the other thing we have, there is a recipe for the shortbread cookies on your handout. And the other thing we have for you is we brought some poppy seeds from our Ella Ruth garden. That's this garden here. And in the springtime, it's just full of poppies. And poppy is an herb, too. It's also an herb. We know poppy seeds. We know we use them in baking. And we also know what heroin comes from poppies. And it was a powerful drug back in, back when they did operations, they needed something to put people out, and that's what they used. So I want to tell you about our cookbook. And I just read that groups aren't doing cookbooks anymore because they're too expensive to do any, with printing costs going up. But this is our cookbook, and we have all of our favorite herb recipes in there. And it's special because all of the illustrations were done by one of the prisoners in one of the units here. Huntsville is known for its prisons. So we had one of the prisoners do all of the illustrations in the book. So that's kind of a cool thing. And if you don't have a book about herbs, I recommend this book because it just has everything. It has, it's all herbs that we can grow here. Judy Barrett is she lives in the hill country. So she knows what grows here. So these have stories about the herbs, they have how to grow them, they have recipes. It's just a great little book for a lot of the herbs that we can grow. Okay, so now I'm going to turn it over to what, Jean or Gloria?
Something. She learned about rosemary being in a different genus and species now.
I may not do it. I still refer to that old book. You know, you never.
It's a great little book.
Thank you.
I'm sorry. Okay. Oh, that's right. Okay. Do you want for yourself?
No, I can make a copy.
Okay. Okay. So I'm Gloria Hunter. And
I forgot her badge.
I forgot my badge. Both of them. And I am a master gardener, Anna. And I've been an Herb Society member. This is my 20th year. So
wow.
I'm really proud of that. Anyway, I have three herbs that I'm going to talk to y'all about today. And one of them, are y'all familiar with this bell pepper basil? Basil?
No.
The good thing about this basil, and y'all are all going to get one.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. I guess it'll be perennial for them.
Yeah, I think so. Well, even if it isn't, but I would tell you that when you take this home and I would put it in a pot first. Mm-hmm. It's been in this one a little while. Well, some of them are root bound, but I would pinch these off. Okay? Don't worry about it. Because you want it to grow, and it's not, you know, winter is coming. The nice thing about this one, it's a perennial. It's going to come back. So even if it dies down to the ground, mm-hmm. it will come back. Okay? Mm-hmm. And I would put it in a pot first in the spring, then I would take it and I'd put it in the ground. And then you give it a whole half a year or a year to grow, and it's going to be a nice big bush. Really, really pretty.
Oh, wow.
And it'll put these out again, and they're kind of purpley, and the bees like them. But I will, and this is your caution, it can be very invasive. And when I say that, it's because those little seeds, they're going to go everywhere. The reason I have so many of these, it's because they grow everywhere. And I tell my husband, don't mow over there. All the little bell pepper basils are coming up, and I'm going to go over there. And after a rain, they are really, really easy to pull up. So you just pull them up, and I pot them up, and then we have them every year. But then, don't want that to go in there. The bell pepper basil, the history, it comes from Mexico. And my understanding is that we had a well-known Herbie, Madeline Hill, and her and Gwen were in Mexico, and they found this, and so she brought it back. And so I don't even remember when it was introduced, but we've had it for a little while. But you'd be surprised, you can't always find it in the box stores and stuff. So, but plant it. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
But in the spring, you'll get a whole bunch of the little seed pods, and like if you don't care, let it go. But if you want to control it, as soon as they turn brown, I would cut them off, and then you can plant them individually. But I would just let them self-seed. Let's see. Oh, the other thing I want to tell you, I don't know if very many of these. When the leaves are little bitty like this, they're great, great, great if you just put them in your salad. So if you're one of those that likes bell pepper in your salad, it's awesome for that. When they get a little bigger like this one, I would just take several of them, I would roll them up and cut them up in snips. And if you do a stir fry or something, you can put them in anything that you'd like that bell pepper flavor. Or if you do bell pepper,
tear like, one of your leaves. Just tear one of the bottom leaves.
Yeah. No.
Tear one of your leaves and let it sit.
Oh, and I'm going to tell you, if you take this and just, and you can feel it. I mean, you can smell the scent of bell pepper all
over.
Oh,
I can now.
And if you eat it, yeah. Well, because when you do that and you rub the bottom, you break open the little oil pots that
capsules that are underneath there, and that's why you can smell it. They use it like you would use bell pepper. Like if I was going to make Mexican rice, and I, when you know, when I'm browning the rice, I put onion in it and I put bell pepper in it. So then I can put these in there and just keep stirring it up until it, and then finish fixing it up.
How is that in a pesto?
It's great.
Oh yeah, absolutely. So if I was,
Pesto. It'd be interesting pesto.
Uh-huh,
yeah.
I think so too. So if you're going to do regular basil pesto, add some of these. It'd be wonderful.
So when we take these home and put them in pots, do we need to put them in the house, or they can stay outside?
No, they could stay out. But I would just keep it in a pot. In case you're going to get a frost this first time, maybe I would bring it inside just to protect it until it gets, because this stem will get a little woody, okay? And then, but like I said, in the spring, feel free, put it in the ground and let it get. It
she
makes a nice little bush.
South of Conroe, so y'all they're getting a bit further north.
Yeah, but it doesn't like, you know, most herbs like a lot of sun, all day sun. Mine are not in full sun. They're in morning sun, and then in the afternoon, they don't get that 4 o'clock sun. So if you do, it'll kind of, it's like lemon balm. It'll get a little bit brown on the edges. So do you want to take one for that lady?
Yeah, I will, yes.
And would you like one?
Yeah, that'd be great. Thank you.
Says I'm all right.
Well, thank you.
Okay. Now that I got off this subject a little bit, let me see if I covered everything. Dries well and also retains its color and flavor when frozen, microwaved, or cooked. And it's an excellent culinary variety. Withstands cold better than other basil varieties, we talked about that, and can be overwintered indoors with plenty of light. Pretty spikes of maroon pink flowers and it add interest to the herb garden. Okay. And it is a perennial. Yes.
And you freeze these for the freezer?
Sure. Mm-hmm. Just pick them up and freeze them. Okay. And then, how about basket flower? Does anybody know basket flower? No? Okay. This is basket flower. But I want to show y'all the one that's out here too. Let me grab it real quick. This just right here. I didn't bring mine from home because I knew we had plenty here. This is considered an herb also. And as you can tell, when it gets a lot of sun, the leaves turn kind of purplish. And it'll throw out a big old bloom like this. And it's white and fragrant. You will absolutely love it. So, I'm going to put this over here. And if you would like a cutting.
Oh, yeah.
See how it does?
Absolutely.
See how it does these? Like this? All I do is just cut them off. Yeah, I dropped one. And just put it in the pot. If you have this laid, or if you have it growing, and it touches the ground, it'll root itself.
Wow, that's amazing.
So it's really, really easy. You know, when we first got these, they weren't out for a long time, and now I see them in more of the nursery. And I'm talking like our nursery or Mercer or some of the other nurseries, not box stores. But here you go. There's one.
Is this the next? This is the Calusia?
Yes.
I'm not saying it right, I'm sure.
Here you go.
Thank you.
Do you need two? If you do,
I'll keep it alive for her for next week. Our next I see you, thank you.
Just like that.
Just like that. Okay. So let me see what else I had on here. Marianne's probably a lot better about saying this. Calusia fragrance?
Yeah, Calusia.
Okay. It says it's an indoor ornamental. If you will notice, we have it right over there in this. Now, we do bring them in for the winter, okay? So we just bring them in here, this hot house, and they're dead, and they just do fine, and then we bring them back out again. But during the winter, expect it's going to keep growing, and if you put it, like I said, close to the ground, and it sends out those little shoots, they will, and instead of just yanking it, just cut them all off and pick up the pot, and then just take all the little babies and pine them up, okay? The leaves are oblong or oblongate. See how they're just really long? I think it's a pretty, pretty plant. Really, really, really pretty. And it becomes violet as y'all. That's why I like this one, because y'all could see that purple on it right away. And the basket actually came from Mexico also. And it naturalized in the West Indies and it's scattered locations all over the United States. The nice thing about it, it is an herb, but it also has medicinal properties and it has antiviral and antimicrobial plant. And it's especially in Eastern Europe, its leaves are used for treatment of various skin diseases, burns, and joint disorders. So I think they make an ointment out of it. We haven't experimented enough with it to make it. We just know we've been studying it. So, does anybody have any questions?
Someone gave me a plant last fall or last spring and said, "This is a giant wandering Jew." And so I thought, "Oh, that's interesting. I know it's that plant."
It looks exactly a lot like a Jew.
I have
yeah.
both of them, and so I thought, "Oh, this is interesting. It's doing the same thing, you know." And I'm going. But I want to see it bloom to see that they're the same.
Yeah, well, because you have one in your greenhouse that bloomed, I remember. Yeah.
Do you remember? Oh, the basket flower.
Yeah, the basket flower.
This giant wandering Jew. It has a tag from a nursery.
Oh, it says wandering. Oh.
It says giant wandering Jew. So we're going to find out.
Yeah. You know, sometimes you have to wonder about some of those tags. Like, I'd also collect begonias. And I was in a nursery, and it said this was a trailing begonia. And I went, "Oh my gosh, this is so pretty!" And it just went everywhere, and it's kind of in a topiary shape like this. Well, then you know, you go home and you Google it and find out it's not a begonia at all. But they, because of the leaves are really, really pretty and stuff, they just call it that, but it's not even in that family. And I thought, well, that's okay, I love it anyway, so it's not a problem. I'm going to keep it. Before we get off the subject very long, I know, oh no, you haven't talked about it, never mind. Skip that. We'll come back to it when she does her presentation. The other one, do y'all like edibles? Like spinach and all that kind of stuff? Okay. I can give y'all a handout. One for you.
Thank you.
Well, that one for you. And two for you. I made enough.
Okay.
Well, I think there's two there. A couple of years ago, we have a master gardener here who's always going to Galveston to their plant sales. And so she comes back with all kind of interesting stuff for us. So she came back with these two spinaches. And this is what? This one in particular is called Okinawa spinach. And if you'll notice, the leaves are kind of purpley on the bottom. Mm. And I just know they're good for you, so let me tell you about them. It's a native of Indonesia, and the leaves are shiny dark green on top. You can pass this around if you want to. And they're iridescent purple underneath. It's not a true spinach, it says, but I want you to know, I pick those leaves and I mix them in with my regular salad. They have really, really, really good flavor to them. They're a little bit on the tart side, I would tell you, but they're really, really make a nice addition. No, that's okay.
It's okay.
Yeah, we'll clean it up. Don't worry about it. It does well in any type of soil, from sandy to clay. It also does well in any type of light, other than full shade, and it will do best, however, in full sun to part shade. You know, I do my cuttings, and I don't necessarily put it in full sun. And it seems to grow really, really well. When we first got this, they told us that they weren't cold tolerant. So I thought, oh, I better protect these and put them in the greenhouse during the winter time. But I missed a couple of them, and they didn't look so pretty, but they made it through the winter. Now remember, I live in Conroe, so it's a little warmer. And I was like, oh, it's okay. So I just cut all the little bad parts off of it and got it going again. So I have a lot of starts of this. So we'll have it at our spring sale.
we plant it every year, and you'd be surprised how many people that do eat greens and eat vegetarians and stuff buy these. And when they find out we have it, they get really excited about it. So, and it makes a nice addition to the garden. See how pretty it is? Because it's got the purple on the bottom and stuff. I think it's a pretty plant. Oh, yeah, it gets big. It gets so big, I would tell you, you could probably put it in a hanging basket, and it would be really pretty to overflow. But then when it gets so big, it's one of those that you could just cut all the tips off of it, shape it again, pot them up, and you'd have a whole bunch of them. I mean, it's really, really, really easy to grow. Real easy. You'd have to work really, really hard to kill it. So there it is. Super easy to propagate. We'll begin rooting in water in a matter of days. I don't put mine in water. I just put it back in soil. But I do use Fertilome, the kind that doesn't have a fertilizer in it, until it gets going, and then I'll start to feed it. The other one is called a longevity spinach. And this one is totally green. And it's supposed to be really, really good for your brain. Yeah, and it's supposed to be a help with your cholesterol. That's what it says on here. And it's Gynura procumbens. It's also is native to the Philippines, and it's in the same genus as the Okinawa. So this one and that one are related to each other. Okay. Longevity is lower growing than in Okinawa. This leafy vegetable was relatively unknown in the U.S. until recent years. So like I said, we probably got it about 3 or 4 years ago, maybe a little bit longer than that. And it seems to, the popularity is growing more and more. It's a perennial, it says, in zone 9 and above. So I'm like at 8.5.
You're probably 8B.
Yeah. And so I would just tell you, if you don't want it to totally die and you have some, then put it in there. When we go to do, I don't have a problem in the world taking and cutting some of these off to give everybody if you'd like to propagate some, okay? The growth habit is ready, so it does. This one again, I put one in a, that's what I was gonna tell you. If you put it in a hanging basket and if you have a nice place that you can hang it, this gets really, really big, so you can just cut it off, pull the leaves off of it. And if you have it close by, then it's easy for you to pick it to make a salad with, you know, or something. Or use it in a stir fry, just like you would use spinach, that you could, you know, put some onions and garlic and put your spinach leaves in there and make a stir fry. That's really, really well with that.
So it tastes like spinach versus?
Kind of. Mm-hmm.
Kind of versus bitter?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It has a little bit of thicker leaf than spinach.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
And, there's a lot of little leaves in here, so if you want to take a little and taste it, you're more than welcome. let's see. Leaves and young stems can be eaten raw, cooked. This is an excellent salad greener. Use the leaves on sandwiches in place of lettuce. Stems can be chopped in soups, stews, or vegetable medleys. The way you'd use celery. Leaves hold their texture well when cooked, making this a good choice for those who don't like the mucilaginous texture of the many other cooked greens. Like some people think, you know, that's stuff that comes like when you cook okra, and they go, I don't want to put that in. I don't like the way that feels in my mouth. Like that. It grows well in full sun or parched shade, and growth slows or stops in cold winter, and a hard freeze will kill top growth. So that's what happened when I left it out. It just killed the top part of it, so I was able to trim it back, and then it came back. This, it grows rapidly, especially in the spring and summer. I mean, rapidly. So if you're not eating it all, you have to really take cuttings of it and propagate it, because it'll get huge. It'll be a big basket if you just let it go. You don't want to do that. You want to go ahead. The plant quickly regenerates from the root system. In spring, the plants go through a flowering cycle when leafy green slows, but it's covered in orange blooms, attracting monarch butterflies to the nectar. Mm. There you go, Jean. Many helpful claims have been made for this vegetable, and it has been used in folk medicine for years in Southeast Asia to treat inflammation, rheumatism, viral infections, and type 2 diabetes.
So it's got a lot of medicinal qualities to it also.
Add it to your smoothies.
And what?
Smoothies.
Oh yeah, it's really, really good in smoothies. We like to do that also, so. And I guess that's all I have. That's my three little herbs, right? So does anybody have any questions? No? Okay, just remind me if anybody wants cuttings I can take, and I can take some off of this.
They're going to want cuttings, I can promise you.
Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Well, I'll tell you what, I'll take cuttings, and then the lucky person will do like a little something. We'll take the whole little plant. Mm-hmm. And the same thing with this one, but I have some over there where we can take some more cuttings. I just got to go get my snips. And Jean.
Okay. Well, I gave you all the reading things, so we're not going to go over every little part. I'm just going to tell you some things that we do or that I do. But, okay, so I'll start with Roselle. And that's the... Gloria, would you go get me the
carrots? Oh, yes.
We plant it in the spring from seed, or you can do a cutting, but I do seed. And it gets, mine is bigger than this table. I'll show you the picture on the one here. It's huge. And these calyx are what you get the red zinger tea from. So, you make tea, and I didn't make that tea, but I did make, this is jelly. See how pretty this jelly is? I was gonna serve it, and Reggie said I couldn't serve it.
Well, I saw Reggie walk away. He's not here right now.
So. He's gone. We could just stick our finger.
Isn't it pretty?
Very pretty.
It makes a really pretty gel. It's kind of tart because I use Pomanos. Are you familiar with that pectin? Well, I never use your gel anymore because...
Can you pass it around?
Yeah.
Oh, my mercy.
And the part
what
that
is
you...
What is
it's Roselle. That's
oh my
this.
Gosh.
That is beautiful.
Wait, do you see the plant out here?
Oh, my
beautiful.
God.
Well, the part that you use is this calyx. So you take the... That's the seed pod. But it's not going to be good unless it stays on the plant until it gets dark. And that's what... I let some stay at the very end. But the calyx is what you use to make your tea.
It's so pretty. Mm-hmm. So you're using this part?
No,
you the red.
The red.
Oh, the red. You use the red after it turns dark.
No.
The red doesn't turn dark. The inside turns dark. Then you use the red.
Well, the red will turn dark eventually. But in order for the seeds to be viable, they need to dry on the vine.
Okay. I understand what you're saying. I was not following very well.
Yeah. That, but that's
it's a hibiscus.
Right. It's a hibiscus.
It looks like hibiscus.
It looks like a hibiscus.
The flower is the smaller.
I actually have a picture of the hibiscus flower.
And you can say where this grows.
No, I'll show it Mary Ann the calyx.
But when you dry that to make tea, and it makes a really dark tree, but you can find it in a lot of Hispanic markets, but now you can find it in Coco Nature even. It's called Jamaica.
Yes.
In Spanish. Jamaican, I guess, is what you would say it in English.
Jamaican.
Yeah.
And is it only this plant itself, the calyx, it doesn't have additions to it?
No. So you can fix it yourself.
Well, I know that, but I mean, what you find it, I've never found it in the store.
They make hibiscus tea, sort of, or Jamaica tea, yes?
I'm sorry, what was the question?
I'm sorry. The tea that you go to the store, you buy the Jamaica, you can boil it up and make the tea with it, correct?
Correct. Uh-huh. And it's in a plate, it's in a bag, and there's like a jillion in there, and I usually do like about 6, and I put them in a little thing of water, and I add it in my pitcher. It's about a 2-quart pitcher, but then I add water and I add ice, and I use stevia a lot, so then I just use my stevia. It's pretty, but it's really refreshing. It's good. So this is what it looks like. It's a red one like this. Everybody's going to get this handout. When you go to the Caribbean, or if you go, they don't call it Jamaica, or they don't call it red zinger. They call it sorrel. And there's a recipe on here for sorrel.
Sorry, Jean.
That's okay.
I need to go make some more coffee, so I'll be back in a minute. So anyway, it's delicious. And I didn't realize that it was one and the same. So I bought me a bottle and I had it. I said, oh, I just love this. This is so good. So then I went home and I Googled it. And I went, oh,
we have this. This is red zinger. I said, oh, no problem. But then you add a little more stuff. So you add cinnamon stick, you add orange peel, you add cloves, and you add a slice of ginger. And of course, you sweeten to taste. The nice thing, if you make this at home, you can fix it. You don't have to add so much sugar. I use my stevia, like I said, so then I don't have to worry about that sugar thing. But the recipe is, and it's simple. Yeah, it's got the whole thing on how to make it. Okay,
well, I was going to finish about the jelly.
Yes.
The seed pods, if you boil the seed pods for about 15 minutes and discard them to save the water, and then use that water for your calyx, this has pectin in it. It's natural pectin.
Oh, wow.
But I use Pomano. Anyway, I have to order it because it isn't available in my grocery stores, probably not yours either. I think a Whole Foods or something might have it, because it's nothing but pectin. And it you don't have to use sugar. Or you don't have to use as much sugar like you do with just sugar gel. You know, if you have 4 cups of juice, you use 4 cups of sugar. Well, on these, I used 1 cup of sugar to 4 cups of juice. And I didn't even have to use that. You can use stevia or any other kind of sweetener that you want to. So that's the benefit of using the thermometers. And its chef life is like forever. So I ordered off Amazon. Pomonas. Thermometers. And I dry the... you have a recipe also for the sorbet, but I dry the calyx for the tea. Before you put things up, when you dry them like that, be sure they're totally dry, because then you put them in glass jars or whatever, and you have them all year. But this is an annual plant, so it has to be planted every year. But it's well worth it, because it's beautiful for a long time.
You just take cuttings and then replant it?
Well, I actually do it from seed because of the cuttings. Of course, you get it now. And I think, have you not eaten from cuttings?
I haven't, but I just do the seed.
Okay, yeah. You do it from seed.
Because the seeds are easy.
Okay.
I can, when these seeds, we talked about bringing you some seeds, but they aren't finished yet. So when these seeds finish, I'll send some.
Thank you.
That'd be easy. Yeah. And then you plant this, it'll sit there for a while and you'll think, this thing's not doing anything, but it's,
you have to be patient because it doesn't start blooming until September. You think, I'm not going to get anything.
Right.
But then it starts blooming and forming those calyx.
Right. It makes a bigger bush, but it takes a while to do that too, but don't give up on it.
When do you plant?
I'm sorry?
When do you plant these plants?
As soon as frost is gone.
Okay.
I have a greenhouse, so I start all my seed in the greenhouse and just wait until the last frost is gone. Or if you get a late frost to cover it or protect it, because you will lose it. It's gonna, as soon as it frosts, it's gonna be gone. Okay, this is another Asian plant. And I got it at that Galveston plant swap too. The first one that I ever got was the blue peas. It is a blue pea vine. I showed you the flower. Mm-hmm. But the vine is really beautiful. It's comes up, but it starts late too. You know, you think you're not going to get it, and it's going to be this big. But then I guess it was probably end of August before it started blooming. Maybe August. But then you collect those flowers. You can dry them and use them for the tea. This is the tea. And that's what's in my Yeti over there.
That is so pretty.
I drink this as water all day, every day. And so does my husband. But these herbs in here are memory herbs.
That's why she needs her notes.
This is a great magazine if you don't have this and you're interested in herbs, Herb Quarterly. And you just get it once, 3 times a year, 4 times a year. Yeah. And it has so many things. I have so many of these books that I think, oh, I've read that, and I have to go back and find which book it's in. But I make myself notes on the front. So this month, this quarter, it came out with a Minty Memory Tea. And it's simple. And this is all I do. I mean, I keep a big jar. I just bought a sample. I keep a big jar in the refrigerator. It's one or two sprigs of peppermint and one or two sprigs of spearmint. But we grow double mint, which are, it's red stem apple mint. And it's equal amounts of both types of mint. So I just use two or three of those sprigs. And one sprig of rosemary, one sprig of lemon balm, and one sprig of holy basil. So I just keep that in my, and then I, instead of just in water, I put it in my blue tea. So who knows? Do anything you can do. The blue flowers were used for eye treatments, for eye infections like pink eye. It's full of antioxidants and has properties that reverse damage caused to the skin by sugar. Sugar causes skin aging, by the way. It's used in many shampoos and conditioners. Anyway, I'm not going to read all this to you because you can read it for any issue. But it's a great plant to grow. And it's really a pretty plant. And rabbits love it. Thought I'd throw that in. I had to make a little bush around mine, a little fence around mine, and put some in pots because it brings it up. And it's called blue pea because after the flower drops off, there's a pea about this long and it's full of seeds. So that you have to leave it on the vine until it dries and then collect it.
And just replant the seed?
Yep. And you'll think it's not coming up because it's late. It isn't. It's like some of the gingers. One of my gingers I pray over every year because, you know, it's middle May and I don't see a sign on it. And it's one of my favorites, so I'm just like, oh, God, it's not coming. But
is it a hidden ginger? A hidden ginger or just a regular ginger?
Well, it is one of the hidden, it's a curcuma, like the hidden gingers. But it's a surly sunshine. You know, the big hidden gingers get this tall. And this one just gets to about right here, and it's so gorgeous.
And it's pink, right? Mm-hmm. Pink, right? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I have some pictures I can share with you later and show you. And I can't dig. I've tried and tried and tried to dig it, and I finally got one little. Is yours living? I gave you one little piece of it.
It's expanded.
Yeah, it's good. Is it? See, mine is planted where it got the junior got under tree roots. So it manages to work its way out and come out, but I can't hardly dig and divide it. I got one little piece started. But I planted another little piece in a part that I hope will stay where I can dig it. I don't know. So that's what I have about the blue pea. And I can save seeds of that also. I don't know. I don't ever see that in the groceries, do y'all?
I'm beginning to see it.
You are beginning to see it?
They have it. Grower's Outlet have it.
Okay.
Not the box stores. The other groceries.
But, and there's a lot of good places like that to go find different things, but Walmart and Home Depot. And it's really kind of dangerous buying edible herbs or even citrus trees from like Home Depot. Because they treat, or Costco, anywhere, I guess. I guess the sellers treat the roots. Right. And it's, you're not supposed to let your honeybees eat it for like 3 years.
Right.
Really?
Well, how do you stop that?
For that to finally grow out of it.
Go out and clip it, yeah. Well, nowadays, even your small little bedding plants, it'll have a tag that tells you it's been sprayed.
Yeah, so be careful when you're buying. You know, it's better to buy from people like us or Mercer or a reputable place that does a lot of their own cuttings because it's kind of scary what you look for the extra little tag in there.
Yeah.
And it'll even, they're bragging about it. This has been treated so that it's not going to have buds.
Yeah, but we won't be.
It's awful.
That's right.
Also going to be bad for you. Okay, so a little curry leaf. Where's our curry plant?
That's right. I'll go get it. All right, tell them about the curry leaf.
Yeah, can you get a little, can Just a little stem, so it's not just one.
I actually got a curry leaf 2 years ago when we were here as a door prize. It was on all the tables, and I ended up with a curry leaf. And now it's about, no, it's probably about 2.5-3 foot tall. My son refers to it as the bacon plant because as he walks by, he likes to nibble on the leaf, but it kind of has a meaty, bacony smell in his opinion.
Oh, yeah.
It's really cool.
So
have you
kept it outside? Well, I move it in the winter.
Yeah, right. I was going to say you have to do it.
Yeah, but,
well, you know what?
But if you don't, it comes back.
Well, yeah. Now, for them, it wouldn't. For me, it did. Mine's about this big, the one that I left outside, because I was playing with it to see. But we have one at the Ellerooth Garden in Huntsville, and it's beautiful. Mm-hmm. And it's been 3 years. Is this 3rd year?
It's at least 2 years. 2 years.
But so you never know, but I would not take a chance at your place.
Oh, no, I don't. I don't.
Yeah.
What zone are y'all?
We're in zone 8A. Oh, okay. Well, we're kind of right on the AB line.
Yeah, I think
okay.
They're right.
Okay. Well, you might. I'm AB.
I am
too. Just like straight this way.
Yeah. Surely you're 8A.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, OSR, Highway 7, somewhere around in there is what we consider maybe that dividing line. So we're more A than B.
Yeah, I think so too. That has yours bloomed yet?
No, I haven't seen it bloom. No.
Well, it will. It, especially probably maybe next summer. You leave it out on a deck or something mm-hmm. in the summertime, and it'll just make the little black berries.
Okay.
After it blooms, those berries you can't let them dry. You have to get them when they're black. They'll turn. Mm-hmm. They're green first, aren't they?
Yeah, they're first a little white bloom, and then they're green, and then they turn black.
Yeah.
Right.
But after they're black, you stick them in their soil.
Okay.
And you can't, and that's why they're so different and special, is because you don't, people want them, but you can't buy seed because once they ship the seeds, they're ruined.
Well, I was wondering how to propagate it. Now I know.
Yeah. So, and it'll sometimes do it itself. If you don't get it, it'll drop it into its pot and make its own roots. But it's a, you can use it like bay leaf. But it's not as strong. I mean, you know, it's a mild taste. It's not as not as tough. Like a bay leaf, you know, you get your bay leaf out before you eat. But that can be just mixed in with your food. I use it in soups and stews and Indian dish, I think. They do sweet potatoes and potatoes in a skillet, stir frying, and they'll just throw that in there once it gets hot, and it just imparts the flavor. So it's a great herb. I don't. It has a lot of medicinal properties.
One of our members says that it helps cover her gray hair. Make a solution on it.
This is it, and I use it. Well, it doesn't cover. Mine's kind of. I'm too old. Mine's getting gray anyway. But this is fractionated coconut oil. And that's what I mix it with. And you dry the leaves. I don't think it ever uses it not dry. I've dried the leaves. And you get this warm, and then you put them in there. And I can't remember how long. I guess maybe it's in here. But, hair. Well, anyway. And then I put it on there, like, before I'm gonna wash my hair, I'll put it on there and let it stay hours if I'm doing something. You know, if I'm getting busy, I just do that and put a thing around my head and go about to my business and then shampoo it. We'll see. Who knows? I mean, I've been doing it about a year.
She's going to have black hair.
Well, I think it also keeps it from falling out.
Yeah,
that's my big thing. Is mine's so thin and fine anyway.
So. You need to try rosemary.
Yeah, I'll have to do one of rosemary and one of maybe the rinses of rosemary.
There you go.
So, anyway, it's a really good herb. I just wanted you to see some things that you're not familiar with all the time. And I don't know, did I have another one?
Ashwagandha.
Oh, yeah. Have you seen the pills, the supplements, ashwagandha?
I've heard that, but I don't know.
Well, this plant in my garden is about this big.
Wow.
And it's an annual, and you grow it, and then you wait until, I've been trying to determine, it says when you start seeing these, see the berries on here? When you start seeing these get brown and then this is the berry, well then it's time to dig it. But see, I have half of those and half the green, so.
You don't know when to dig.
No, you're right, I've got to do some more research.
So cool.
But the roots are, it's what you use. Mm-hmm. You dig the roots up, and they're not gonna be big like a ginger root or a horseradish. It's gonna be more of a small root. But you just clean it off good, and then you dry it, and then make a powder out of it. And that's what all the medications are. Mm-hmm. Well,
oh, wow.
Not medications, I guess, supplements.
Supplements, yeah.
But it's a lot of people take it, of course, I don't have any depression or all that kind of stuff. So.
Not me neither.
It says it reduces stress and anxiety, and controls the cortisol levels.
I read that it's good for male virility.
That's good for what?
Male virility.
Oh, yeah, I have to, yeah. I think that's on
you. You might not want to give it to your husband.
Cannot. Anyway, it's an ancient herb, and this is the first year we tried to grow it, isn't it? I think we just thought, well, why not? So I'm going to do it. I'm going to see what happens. I'm going to get the root up and grind it up. We'll see what happens. So, do y'all have questions? There's so many herbs that we love and use, and it was impossible. That's why it's so nice to come out, like, to my house, or even this one. You need a tour of this garden, too. But it's so nice to have your herbs that you can just go out and get when you need them, you know, and it's...
Poppy seeds, and these are from our Alla Ruth garden, and they're orange. They're beautiful, beautiful flowers in the spring. No, plant them after Thanksgiving, right after Thanksgiving. If you mix the seeds with sand, it'll help to, to spread them out, and then just sprinkle them in your garden where you want them to come up, and you don't need to cover the seeds up. They'll just come up by themselves. And what you have to watch for them in the spring, because they kind of look like weeds when they start coming up. It's kind of real fern. It's a ferny looking plant when it starts coming up in the spring. But once you have them, you'll have them all the time because they recede.
It's a light green, kind of bluish green, yeah. Little rosette thing that starts coming up. So be careful what you pull up in the spring.
Yeah.
I think people who say my seeds didn't take, I think that's what happens.
Yeah,
they pull up the
mulch over them or do something.
So yeah, so remember where you put them and then watch for them in the spring. It's really a gorgeous, spectacular.
Well, they come up before other things do too. I mean, a lot of weeds are coming up then, so it's just like the.
Can you put them in a pot?
Sure.
Yeah. I mean.
They don't transplant.
If you put them in a pot and try and transplant, they don't do well.
They're terrible. Dill is like that. I have tried dill. Blue bonnets. If I get blue bonnets when they're this big, I can transplant them. But they don't like to be transplanted. Parsley, a lot of things don't like to be transplanted. They won't be planted where it's going to be. But those, we have them too thick sometimes at the garden.
Yeah, well, they just come up by themselves.
Yeah, but you're better off if you mix it with some little bit of damp sand and throw it out, because they're too, they're so tiny, and if they get too thick, they won't be good.
Here they are. Mm-hmm. That's them in the garden.
Oh, that is so beautiful.
Oh, they are.
It's the cactus.
Do y'all want to walk around in the garden?
Yes. Yes.